So today's agenda will be as follows. We will address pressing challenges for facing businesses today. We'll actually go into the solution, Gigya Enterprise Preference Manager, and we'll talk about Gigya Enterprise Preference Manager use cases, which will include implementation scenarios. And then Sergey will be providing us a demonstration of how Enterprise Preference Manager works. And at the very end, we will be covering Q&A. So let's get started. So remember the days when all of you would opt in to receive information about a specific promotion, but instead you would receive an onslaught of unwanted ads and emails without your consent. Well, these days are absolutely going away. Going forward, business must obtain consent prior to using customer data for anything. Consent must be unambiguous in nature and can only be used for specific marketing purposes. In other words, opting in once does not grant permission for businesses to keep using customer data for other marketing communications and activities. So what are the repercussions for not obtaining customer consent throughout the customer journey? In today's world of digital media and social media, where information is so easily shared, customers are very reluctant to give their personal information away. In fact, a recent study commissioned by Gigya, we found that 2/3 of customers don't really trust their brands with their personal information. But not to be alarmed, there is opportunity here to regain customer trust by ensuring that personal data will be treated with respect and the privacy that they deserve. But first, let's learn about the types of personal data that exist today. There are 2 types of customer data which all global businesses are now responsible to understand prior to communicating with their customers. PII, or personally identifiable information, which is a commonly used term in North America, refers to a relatively narrow range of data, such as name, address, birthday, etc. Personal data, on the other hand, which in context of the GDPR, covers a much wider range of information that can include social media posts, photographs, lifestyle preferences, and transaction histories, and the like. So now business must ensure that customers are in control of their personal data, particularly as the General Data Protection Regulations goes into effect on May 25th, 2018. So what does that mean? If you think about the new regulations that are coming into effect, specifically the General Data Protection Regulations, or the GDPR, the main theme is about giving customers control of their data. The GDPR, which goes into effect in May 2018, is actually over 300 pages long and focuses on individual rights. But what are the individual rights under the GDPR? So some examples: if a company transacts or processes personal data of EU residents, they must adhere to the following rules. Consumers must have the right to be informed when terms of service change and be able to re-grant consent at any given time. This consent must be proactive, proactive notifications when the business strategies or policies change on a digital property, and it must be given in real time. Customers must have the right to access the information that you're storing about them. They have to have the right to update, freeze, delete their account information, which is called right of erasure. They have the right to restrict the usage of their personal data. They have the right to export their data or move their data elsewhere. How can your organization make sure that you remain in compliance with these demands? And we'll discuss that further in the presentation. Okay, so GDPR, that's the big one. So what's at stake? Once again, I mentioned it a couple times already, GDPR begins its enforcement on May 25th, 2018. Why is the GDPR so serious, and why should you care? Well, it applies to any business processing EU personal data, regardless of where the business resides in the world. And businesses who get caught out of compliance will face severe financial penalties. So 20 million euros, or 4% of the annual gross to be exact, whichever is more. So although GDPR is a very scary thing for most businesses, there is also a silver lining for businesses that make an effort to prepare to meet the compliance. Since GDPR is about putting the customer in control of their data, it creates an opportunity to instill customer trust as businesses seek explicit consent to use their personal data. So in a recent study by Accenture, we discovered that 70% of customers will share their personal data if they know how it will be used. And in addition to that, 75% of customers will share their personal data if they're able to control the usage of their data. Or by controlling it, I mean they're able to review what they've consented to, they're able to change it, revoke consent, or deleting their account altogether. So if customers are aware of this, they will share their data, which can be a competitive advantage for you. So why is it so hard to regain their trust overall? Well, customers actually feel, you know, when they're presented with terms of services, they actually feel a lack of transparency and control whenever they're asked to consent to using their data. Customers actually don't even, when they see those terms of services or privacy policies, they agree to it or reluctant to agree, they don't know what they're actually consenting to. They don't really understand the frequency of marketing and the medium they've consented to. They don't understand how businesses are going to be using their personal information. And in today's world, many businesses still assume that if they receive customer consent once, it means it gives them permission to reuse that consent repeatedly over and over again. And that's no longer the case. Lastly, if customers don't have control of their data, they will not be able to exercise their individual rights under the GDPR. But customers aren't the only ones who are at risk. So this is more on the business side of things. This is more on your side. So businesses falling out of compliance is the biggest danger. The burden of proof of collecting consent falls on the business. So if businesses don't have a governance in place to collect consent, if there's no secure and centralized place to store that consent, or they are not able to procure consent in an event of an audit, they can't prove explicit consent, which then falls out of compliance. Another area of a business, if a business can't keep up with evolving privacy regulations. So privacy regulations evolve every day, they change every day, and it's up to the business to be able to accommodate those changes quickly and efficiently. And they have to be able to prove that they can change it quickly and efficiently. And lastly, enforcement. If a business can't enforce consent consistently, then they will be out of compliance, such as being able to update terms of service and privacy policies as they change in real time. If they're unable to trigger a request or reconsent terms of services, they could be out of compliance. If there's different versions of consent and preferences that exist, and accurate consent is not applied across the marketing ecosystem, they can be out of compliance. So exposure to regular scrutiny if a customer consent and preference aren't synced across marketing, sales, services, and applications. That's what we're talking about when we mention can't enforce consent consistently. But imagine if you could have a solution that not only presents terms of services and data privacy at point of initial interaction, but also can re-trigger consent when policies change. Know that the recorded consent for all activities, such as terms of services, data privacy, opt-in communications, are stored in an audit-ready and secure place that can be used for auditing purposes should the need arise. Lastly, offer customers the ability to view and control their profile preferences and consent to activities with the confidence that opt-in communication are synchronized across downstream systems. Okay. Now I'm going to go ahead and turn it over. Now I'm going to go ahead and talk about the Gigya solution, which is Enterprise Preference Manager. So to build trusted relationships, you have to have a customer identity management platform in place, and with that, Enterprise Preference Manager. So how is this done? It begins with capturing preferences and consent. Here, terms of services, privacy policies, cookie consent, and consent to custom marketing activities are presented to a customer at time of registration. Now, version control. Now, why would there be version control here? So when business policies or marketing tactics change or regulations evolve, there could be a need for customers to re-consent. So first, Enterprise Preference Manager enables businesses to automatically trigger consent renewals at login. This creates a version of consent which customers and regulators must be able to access at any time. This is particularly true in the event of an audit. In addition to that, Enterprise Preference Manager tracks consent history for the life of the customer. Current and historic consent can be easily procured for the auditors. Enforced consent, and I mentioned that earlier. So a business that has captured consent at registration or updated consent at login, this consent has to be enforced throughout the marketing ecosystem. Enterprise Preference Manager synchronizes the profile data, the preferences and consent to downstream marketing, sales, and services applications. And lastly, profile preference and consent. There must be a self-service center to view, modify, profile, preference, and consent information. There must be a place for customers to be able to withdraw consent or download user data at any given time. So this is all about giving customers control, which is a significant pillar to the GDPR. So Enterprise Preference Manager gives control back to customers. As I mentioned earlier, GDPR ultimately gives control back to the customers, and this is done through a self-service preference center, which is all built into Enterprise Preference Manager. In there, the customers are able to view and change their profile data. They are able to view and change customer preferences, their likes and interests from a centralized location. They're able to review their select communication channels they've opted into, or to change, delete, or delete at any time. They're able to view the communication frequency they've opted into and to change it at any time again. The customer preference must be easy and accessible so they can view and change at any time. All present policy agreements, particularly the most recent ones, must be easily accessible. And customers may be able to access all past and present consent history that were requested on the, as the policy site policies changes. Once again, customers like to have control of their personal data and must be able to do so with the following actions at their discretion: view info, add info, modify info, delete information, withdraw consent, or request to freeze it. And all this can happen within a self-service preference center. Now I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Yaron, who's going to go into some use cases and some implementation scenarios. Yaron?
So thank you, Natalie. And before we go into some of the use cases that we can have for an enterprise platform manager and to see the synergy with CIM or customer identity management platform, let's understand the difference between what the CIM platform feature function are and what is the function that an enterprise platform manager or EPM has. So on the slide that we see right now, we can see that on the left side, we can see that CIM solution is mainly handling registration of users as well as authentication, authorization, or identity in particular. While on the right side, we can see that the main feature and function of an EPM is more or less around how to capture consent or how to define different type of consent workflow, whether they are the terms of service, privacy policy, or communication, as well as how to handle all the user profile, the communication preferences, personal preferences, device or preference center itself, as well as the ability to enforce consent of all the downstream and upstream application, which we're going to see some slides later on. So let's begin by going into the first use case, which is around registration. So it all begins when the user registers, let's say, to a property, and that is being handled by a CIM solution. And during the registration, some information being captured beyond, let's say, beside the identity of the user, as well as capturing all the terms of service and privacy policy and other type of consent. And that information is being stored by the EPM, as we can see on the right side. Once the user is then logged in, we can collect additional preferences and those information is also being stored in the EPM. And following that, we have the identity information that is stored in the CIM, while everything else, which is the profile and preferences and the consent, is being stored in the audit ready vault of the EPM. Let's say moving forward in a point of time, we can have terms of service or privacy policy that are being changed. And with that happened, and that's related to use case number three, when we have the users that are going to come online, we're going to prompt them and ask them to reconsent to the new policy. And once they do that, we're going to capture this renewal action and make sure that we have the up-to-date consent for that terms of service. Use case number four is talking about, let's say, a scenario where, for example, you have multiple properties under the same, single sign-on, and you have a global consent that is being captured for the user when they registered, but there is one brand has an additional terms of service that need to be accepted before you can get access to. So that's something that we can support, we can define. And when the user is going to, let's say, attempt to access brand B, again, we're going to prompt them and show them that there is a need to grant consent for the additional terms of service. And when that is being collected, this is what is going to be captured into the EPM. Again, this is an example in how we can earn customer trust by showing them or treating them or notifying them where there are new policies in place. So this example, we can see that the user that we tried to log in into Gigya fashion and there was some terms of service change, you can see that information and is able to view the terms of service before accepting them. And only when they're going to accept them, they're going to get or they're going to regain access back to the Gigya fashion site and continue to enjoy its features. Moving on to the next functionality, it's around, let's say, capturing preferences, and the first two use cases around communication preferences. And here is the first time that we're going to talk about not just about registered users, but also about pre-registered users. And those are anonymous users that can potentially come visit the site even without having, an account. And they can still opt into marketing communication or opt in to receive some product information, whether a single opt-in policy is being enforced or double opt-in. And once this is happening, again, the opt-in information to that communication channel is going to be captured by the EPM, and later on is going to be distributed to the fulfillment system, whether it's an ESP or whatever marketing automation system that take control of that. The third use case is about how we can share some, let's say, data, personal data of the user. So let's say that there is like a business partner that needs a certain data from the user, like let's say the first name and last name, so they can show it to them along their customer journey there. So we are able to prompt the user and ask them to consent to share certain piece of data of the profile. And when they do that, then we are going to provide that data to this business partner so they can make use of that on their website. Moving on to kind of a preference of the use case of what the user can do when they want to and when they have a change of mind. So for every, let's say, communication consent that has been given to any communication preferences, the user in any point of time, whether they are a registered user or they are a pre-registered user, they can come online and opt out from that communication channel. And if there is a data permission that has been granted, again, they can withdraw that consent and have this information deleted from whatever business partner that got this information. And again, if there is a consent that was granted for a limited period of time, user doesn't need to go online and request it to be withdrawn, but instead the EPM is automatically revoked within the expired time frame. So this is an example of how a preference center looks like. And what we can see, it's more of a self-service UI that is split into, let's say, three views. On the left side, we can see a profile screen where users can come and see what kind of information has been collected from them. And in any given point of time, they can change everything that has been captured. On the screen on the middle, we can see this is more of a privacy setting screen where the user can see to which policy they have consented, the version, They can click on the link there to view the actual policy that they've been consulted before. And in the middle, we can see the data permission that they previously granted the consent, and in any point of time, they can withdraw that consent. And on the bottom, additional GDPR action, such as delete account or export it to get the information. On the right side, we can see the sample of a communication preference screen where the user can come and see to which communication channel they are opting in. And any point of time, they can opt out if they change their mind. So how do we set up, or what are the options to set up such a consent workflow? So Gigya APM allows you to define, either an individual consent or individual consent workflow that could be applicable to one property, or it can be a workflow that is applicable for more than one property. And those workflow can be set as, let's say, mandatory if there are terms of service or privacy policy, as we can see from the upper part of the screen. And if there are additional consent workflows such as data permission or tracking policy, those are classified as other statements where they need to be kind of optional from the user perspective, so because they are not obligated under the GDPR, for example, to grant consent for that. Now, when you set up a consent workflow or when you change the version of a policy, you have the option to set whether this change is going to affect all of the user base or maybe part of it, kind of saying whether the new version of the policy is a major change and by that everybody needs to reconsent to that version, or if it's a minor version which maybe affect only people that consented a while back while the majority of the users are not interested at all. So these are kind of the way that we can set up workflow, and we can see later on in the demo how this can be set up. If I look back in all the use cases that I've spoke so far, so basically for every action or for every interaction with the user, there are action or consent actions that are being collected, whether they are the grant or withdrawal, opt-in or opt-out or renewal, etc. So we have a dedicated screen called Consent Vault UI where you can see all the action, all the consent-related actions that are made by the user, and you can see in which property it accrues, timestamp, and other related information that if you let the ability to present it when audit comes by. To summarize what we've seen, so basically Gigya APM allows you to stay in compliance with regional privacy regulation. What does it mean? It means that when you put the APM in between your upstream application as well as your downstream application, you have one system that takes care of the information that is being collected from the user, as well as it enforces the right information that can be distributed to other systems. So that gives you kind of, that helps you to be ready from GDPR perspective. And it makes sure that nothing is being altered unless the user is going to consent, and nothing is going to be distributed elsewhere unless it was permitted by the user. Let's talk a bit about implementation use case. And there are two implementation use cases that we have for EPM. And the first one is where you combine it with both Gigya CIM as well as with the EPM. And then you get to enjoy the best features and functionality of one platform. And I think that I already covered in previously the kind of features and functions that you have. And that will give you, let's say, the benefit of using the leading CIM technology as well as the one that with the EPM that guard you from privacy and regulation perspective. Now, EPM is also available as standalone. So in case you have a third party or in-house identity management piece, so you can always take Gigya EPM and then you'll have the identity piece that take care of the identity information of the user, while the EPM will take care of everything that relates to privacy and profile and preferences and consent.
Thank you, Yaron. So in conclusion, Enterprise Preference Manager is about being transparent, gaining loyal customers, and protecting your business. So let's recap what that means. So being transparent, customers who understand how their personal data will be used will be more inclined to share it, right? Giving customers control of their preferences increases satisfaction, conversions, and the revenues of the business. So gaining loyal customers is about keeping customers informed of changes of business policies, which builds customer trust. mean, your customer's loyalty and therefore financial success actually depends on trust. Lastly, protecting your business. I mean, keep in mind that firms that collect and process personal data, such even customers and prospects, which includes every company, are now at risk. So collecting customer consent in a clear and explicit manner does satisfy GDPR. And enforcing accurate consent across third-party systems eliminates the risk of regulatory scrutiny, and it satisfies audits should they ever come about. With that said, what we're going to do now is have Sergey show us exactly how that's done. So Sergey, take it away.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm sharing my screen here. Yes. Thank you, Natalie. So I'll take you through the user journey of a very common use case. And for that reason, I picked our e-commerce demonstration site. So you're all familiar with the e-commerce experience. We're all doing this on a fairly regular basis. And first and foremost, important component here is you can see that anytime we're kind of touching the digital property in a first time, especially in European regions or countries, we have to acknowledge and accept the cookies, right? This is a kind of initial handshake and probably the first one that was initiated from the regulatory standpoint of acknowledgement of the cookie is gonna be utilized for user experience while you're browsing digital properties. Technically speaking, yeah, we click on this button, we accepted the cookie terms and kind of goes in a black hole. We don't know what's happening. We never can go back and kind of review it. From the consumer standpoint. So this is just a fact, right? From that point on, we always want people to go and browse in the login state, and that's why the registration is kind of a very important component. But it's not always happening that user gonna go and click on the registration button and go through the onboarding or acknowledging all the necessary personal data attributes to go through the registration workflow. In some instances, you might get a little bit lighter on your consumers and offer the functionalities like light registration, subscription, where you can start gathering granularly that personal identifiable data as you go through the journey. But skipping that step, I'll go through the, and if for sake of saving time, I'm going through the full registration process. I'm gonna provide my email address, my first name and last name as required through this registration flow. Again, this form powered by Gigya, and it's part of the custom identity access management platform that Ron was talking about. And this is a second component we are very well familiar, this acceptance of terms of services, right? This is technically the site all sites offer, and I don't think many of us were reading terms of services when we do that. But this is kind of the most common use case for legal consent, right? But keep in mind that that is not limiting to the fact that's going to be enforced by GDPR, especially related to the communication consent. As Natalie mentioned, it's not just the fact that if I provide you my email address and I said I agree with terms of services, that means that by default, you can start messaging and kind of interacting in any sort of engagement with me from the business perspective on all the levels. So I have to give you explicit consent, let's say the subscription to the daily fashion picks. That means that it's not just the channel, but also the frequency, right? I also consent to the cookie. And if you notice, when I consent to the cookies, I was in a logout state, means I was totally anonymous user to your digital property. But when I went through the registration workflow, I carried on that cookie consent into my full converted user record, and now kind of becomes part of my legal consent carrying on moving forward. And then I have a few other components like data collection policy. It means that I have to either read it and accept the fact that my data will be collected. I need to understand how and when the data will be used. And after that, I can carry on and proceed to my site. So I also need to accept the term of services, go back. And now I'm a fully logged in user. So I am part of the website, and many of us know if I want to go back into my portal on my profile, I can see all the data that I kind of provided as a registration form. But that's pretty much what typical commerce site will display, right? So first name, last name, email, pretty much all the data that gets collected at the registration form. Gigya identified three different buckets of preferences, right? First of all, it's a preferences related to my engagement with your site. So those, there's two sources of this data. It either can be collected through the implicit user behavioral trend or can be asked through the user journey. And that's where Gigya offers this progressive profiling to acquire data as the relationship mature about the consumers. I can browse your website, I can follow certain brands, but that might be not my favorite. It could be just the one-time event that I was shopping for particular stuff for either of my family members or my friends, and not necessarily representing me as a person. The second component is the communication consent, right? This is where we are going to be engaging in some sort of marketing campaigns. And if you remember the registration process, I opt into daily fashion fix. And again, as a consumer and as is driven by GDPR, I have ability not just to one time acknowledge that fact, but be able to go back and change and modify my consent, opt out in case I change my mind, or subscribe to additional events, preference, communication preference, if I desire to do so. And the third piece is obviously privacy, right? So this is where we identifying those legal consents that we are giving to the digital brands. And you can see Gigya provides a set of widgets that you can easily incorporate it into your website, that all the terms of service you consented to, the data collection policy, cookie policies that again, you've been consented to. Moreover, as a part of the rights that kind of driven by GDPR is you have to be able not just present this to the consumer, but also be able for consumers to be able to see it, all the data that gets collected on their behalf. And this is the, you know, component and the tools that Gigya offers that allows you to present back to the back to your consumers all the data that gets collected, when and how the consent was granted, with a timestamp, with location, version number, and what you consented to. Moreover, the data can be extracted from your digital properties in a readable format. So, according to the GDPR Data Portability Act, you have to be able to present this data, download this data, import this data if you desire to do so. So this is kind of the very brief overview of what is the front end looks like. What I'll do now, I'm going to log out from the site. I'm going to log in again to the digital properties, and you will notice that when I log in, there's nothing really going to change by just logging into the site, because none of the terms of services have changed, none of the policies changed. It's just basically typical login. When we mentioned about the progressive profiling, we talked about the fact that you can gather this additional preferences from the consumer by triggering certain forms, let's say like this one, what would be your favorite brand, and navigate it and kind of through the certain logic and understanding and planning that the psychological state of the consumer would be appropriate to present additional data attributes to consent to or select from, rather than just trying to kind of do this on in a silent mode on the background. And again, this decisioning, right? So I express what is my favorite brand is, and instead of you just decide it on my behalf, if I want that personalized experience, you have this shared governance where not just the brand driving the personalization, but you as a consumer participating in this decision. Like, yes, I truly want to kind of narrow down your content that you're putting on me to what I prefer. So it's really contextual, it's really relevant, and it's all kind of shared decisioning. So that's what we're all about here. What I'll do now, I'll log out and take you to the backend system, and presumably at some point, and as we mentioned a few times throughout our presentation, consent is not static data. It's not that what you're giving once and that's going to be forever, right? So user can opt in, opt out, but also the terms of services, consent documents might change. And with the sufficient privileges, let's say I'm going to go back to the backend system, that again, administrative console, with the sufficient privileges, you'll have access to this dashboard. And let's say I'm going to change the consent from version 2.4 to 2.5 save this modification on my administrative console. So what's happening now, if I'm going to go back to my digital properties and say this was mandatory change, so user have to kind of go and reconsent because it was a substantial modification to the utilization of this collection of the data, and we have to gather reconsent from the consumers. If I'm going to go back and try to log into the site without any technical effort, I will be prompted to reconsent to modified policies again. So I'll do that, and in this case, I will be logged in. But again, on my on user record for Sergey, now I have this reconsent record being tracked for the auditing purposes if I ever going to be questioned. So going back to the administrative console, all the data gets collected, and if you notice, we have quite a few terms of services. Also, Gigya support this notion of single sign-on and site grouping, means that you might have a different site kind of unified under one umbrella. And if I need to, let's say you have terms of services for fashion site, but also you have terms of services for competition site. If I need to, and obviously they are different. So we all saw that on the fashion side, I had terms of services for fashion site active, but competition site were inactive. So if I navigate from site, fashion site to competition site, although I have single user record kind of shared between those two digital properties, when I navigate to the second site, I will be prompted to consent to the terms of services related to the second site I'm navigating to. If I take to the administrative console, you will see that data gets stored and collected in consent vault. All my activities and engagements related to Sergey's engagement with the digital properties gets tracked. I just consented to collect data, and you see it was renewed and I reconsented where initially I granted my permission. So all the data is available for downloading. There is a pretty substantial and sophisticated search mechanism where I can look up for certain things, accepting terms of services. If I need to look up for the dates that were renewed, withdrawn, created. So all that stuff in one bucket, in one place, and again, available for auditing if necessary. I can spend probably another 30 minutes of giving you all the functionalities and kind of how the data can be cascading with push to downstream application using Gigya services, but I think we don't have that much time and luxury to go over it. Handing over back to David or Natalie.
Great. Thanks so much, Sergey, for that super valuable demo. And thank you again, Natalie and Yaron, for sharing your insights into Gigya Enterprise Preference Manager. So it looks like we've received some great questions from you during the presentation. So let's jump into those now. And our first question looks like it's probably a good one for Yaron. Yaron, does this Preference Manager also support data subjects without user accounts? Think of scenarios like a person who subscribes to a newsletter but has no user account.
Yeah, so that's a good question, and I think that we covered it in one of the slides when we saw a use case for unregistered users. So imagine a use case where somebody that is kind of an anonymous get into the website, and they can see an option to, let's say, to opt into a newsletter, for example, and they don't have to have an account, like, you know, for the questions that have been asked, and they simply need to put their email, maybe some additional preferences, maybe first name, last name, if that's what is required. And when they do that, they can opt into a newsletter without needing to have an account. Let's say in the future, let's say if we manage to convince them to register, we can have them register to the website, and then we're going to still collect the information that they had as a pre-registered user, and that will allow us to know or to kind of understand the journey from being unregistered all the way to being registered users or known users.
All right. Thanks for that, Yaron. Natalie, here's one for you. Question is, my CIM solution has some basic terms of service and privacy policies for customers to agree to. Isn't that enough?
Well, that's the beginning, but then there will also be some custom marketing activities that will also be added to that, that the customers must be able to must consent to, in addition to privacy policies in terms of services, and that all can be automated with Enterprise Preference Manager.
Great. So here's another one for Yaron. When will these new features be available to Gigya customers? And this person says they're already an early adopter Gigya user.
So I think that has been asked. So we have an early adopter program for Enterprise Preference Manager. And if you don't have yet access to this new product, simply get in touch with your account manager. And I'm sure that that can be sorted out.
All right. And this is for either of you, whoever feels comfortable taking this. How is Gigya going to handle the more difficult to implement GDPR compliance issues, such as user data portability, right to be forgotten, extensibility, so on?
Well, I'll take that question. So I think that the most important thing is from, let's say, from IP strategy is to decide where is all the, let's say, data of the user, whether the profile and preference reside. Now, what we recommend is that you place a Gigya Enterprise Preference Manager in between your upstream and downstream application, and therefore propagate all the profile and preference data of the user into one place. And that will allow you to kind of build all the GDPR requirement around the EPM, so basically around one system, rather than go into all your silos of customer data and try to have all the GDPR requirement being implemented and supported per system. So that's kind of our approach. And when you do that, then you're able to impose or enforce what information goes in, what information goes out. And when the user requests to be forgotten, then basically we can trigger all the necessary requests to all the downstream application to delete their data from their side as well.
Great. Okay, here's one for Natalie. Asking customers to consent to every marketing activity can be confusing and complex. What if customers just don't get it and keep abandoning our site?
Well, the nice thing about Enterprise Preference Manager, that risk is definitely decreased because everything is so frictionless. When a customer actually registers on our site, the terms of services, privacy policies, even custom marketing activities are as Sergey pointed out, it's so easy to consent to. They can also view the terms and services and the activities just by downloading and reading them. So that really does minimize, having an application like Enterprise Preference Manager does minimize that risk.
Okay. This is an interesting question, and either of you can take this. Could a user choose not to specifically share their contact info with a partner, like an email address, but still share enough data so they could use the partner service?
So I think that, you know, if you basically look at the GDPR requirement, it's the other way around. By default, nothing can be shared to any business partner unless the user has been asked specifically to what can be shared, and then the user can control if whether they agree to sharing that specific data or not. And obviously, we can support that, and if you define a certain consent that is tied to whatever information that you wish to share with a business partner, then the user has the option to either agree or not agree to that request. And if they do agree, then this information is shared. But again, by default, nothing is shared by a business partner unless the user has consented to.
All right. Here's another one. Interesting. How about gathering explicit consent and cross-border data transfers?
Is that the rest of the, is that the whole question?
That's the question.
Yaron, what do you think about that one?
So I think that, you know, inside within the EPM, we are able to define the let's say the consent workflow that can be applicable to a legal entity. So the question is, what is the restriction of that legal entity? If the legal entity, let's say, is a country in the EU, or maybe related to some countries in the EU, then having a consent legal entity, I think that will satisfy the requirement. Now, if it's a matter of, let's say, cross a legal entity, then obviously a different consent workflow need to be defined or need to be collected for each legal entity, and only if the user has granted access to, or sorry, grant consent to that legal entity, then the data can be shared. Otherwise, we will not share this information with any downstream application of, let's say, system that reside in a different territory.
Understood. Thanks, Yaron. I think this is probably another one for you. Can we build or license your SDK into our platform as a service cloud-based, cloud-based communication platform as part of our solution?
Well, if it's meant for the, let's say, in the integration of within the EPM, then the answer is yes. With the EPM, we kind of offer two methods of integration. One is API-driven, which I guess the SDK will satisfy that. And if you have kind of a time-to-market constraint and you don't think that you'll be ready for GDPR kind of doing yourself, then you can rely on our technology called ScreenSet. And then you can just plug our JavaScript or Web SDK, and we can help you to kind of collect all the, relevant consent quite quickly, and we can have screen set that are there to you, the look and feel of your website.
All right. Here's a punchy one for Natalie. Can we really expect auditors to come knocking after May 25th, 2018? What kind of proof will they be looking for?
So the answer is yes, but according to a recent Forrester report, it indicates that the auditors are actually going to be targeting American companies, American vendors, first, so they could expect to have auditors knocking on their doors. And as far as so, what was part two of the question, David?
Basically what the auditors would be looking for specifically.
Okay, right. So the auditors, what they'll be looking for is to make sure that companies have actually obtained consent to use their personal data. They're going to ask for the initial consent, they're going to ask for the historical consent, and they're going to ask for, you know, when privacy policies or terms of services change, is there a way to trigger those changes so that the customers can re-consent. And they're also going to ask, you know, when privacy regulations evolve, is your system able to quickly and efficiently implement those changes so that the customers can consent to the new policies? So they're going to ask businesses for that information. And they have to be able to procure the consent from customers immediately. And they will not be able to point fingers at the other vendors saying, well, we don't have that information. Our, you know, XYZ vendor has it. You have to be able to procure that yourself.
Okay. And, well, I'll let either of you take this. Does this solution also manage cookie policies similar to how other companies, such as TrustArc?
So I'll take that. So I think that when we've seen the back office of or the places we can create all the consent statements. So obviously we can create there a consent statement for, let's say, a registered user, and then we can ask whether they are agreed to be tracked, and then kind of relay this information to whatever tracking technology that exists on the website. And as for anonymous users, again, that depends on the technology that exists out there, and then we need to see how exactly we can integrate or pass them this information. Obviously, all the cookie consent or tracking, let's say, whether you agree to be tracked, is going to be available in the preference center. So when a registered user or the one that doesn't have an account, which we call as pre-registered user, come to the preference center, they can see the tracking mode, and they can always decide whether they want to switch it on or switch it off for them.
Okay. Let's see. Here's one more. What if a customer has no idea what they've consented to in the past, but we're asking them to re-consent?
Well, that's easy. They can go to their preferences of consent, self-service preference of consent console, and they can actually determine what they've consented to in the past, initially when they registered, download that consent, read through it, and then if they agree that, you know, for the new consent, then they can go ahead and do that, or they can decline. So that's very easy. So everything can be obtained from their preferences and consent center.
Great. And here's another one. If you have customer preferences managed in Gigya, do you then extend that known set of customer preferences with your social media management team?
Yaron, I'll let you tackle that one.
Yeah, so that's a possibility. Again, that depends on the marketing automation system that exists for a client and whether they need this information. And if they do, then obviously when we collect the preference information for the social media, again, for the social network, assuming that the user used a social login to and granted access to the client to get this information, then obviously we can distribute this information to any marketing automation system. But again, it's up to the user to use a social login, or maybe later on, if they use a regular login, let's call it like that, to connect with any social provider such as Facebook, where we can collect the preference information from there as well.
All right. And we have time for just one more before we reach the top of the hour. Natalie, I think this is probably a good one for you, and it's fairly general. Does Gigya Enterprise Preference Manager satisfy GDPR compliance as it pertains to collecting and storing customer data?
Good question. So Gigya built Enterprise Preference Manager with privacy by design principles. So yes, absolutely. It was meant to satisfy GDPR requirements as our clients have requested it. And so that is definitely going to be something that our clients can rely on. If they implement APM, they will be compliant as regards to their identity management platform.
All right. And I'm afraid that's about all the time we have for today. I want to thank you all for joining us. We'll reach out to you in the coming days if any of your questions weren't answered, or if you'd like more information about Gigya or our products. So with that, we'll say goodbye. Have a great rest of your day, everyone.
But thank you, everyone.